My name is Nasrina Basito, and I'm delighted to introduce both Professor Dick French and Dr. Nergis Mavalvala. Professor French is the Louise Sherwood McDowell and Sarah Frances Whiting Professor of Astrophysics and Professor of Astronomy here at Wellesley College. Since 1990, he has been a member of the NASA Cassini mission to Saturn, using data from the spacecraft to study the planet's rings. Professor French also engages his students in contributing to decades of research on the observation of Uranian rings, as students often travel to distant telescopes. A former student of Professor French, Dr. Mavalvala, class of 1990, is the Curtis and Kathleen Marble Professor of Astrophysics at MIT, and the recipient of the 2010 MacArthur Genius Fellowship. Her research uses Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory, or LIGO, to detect gravitational waves following astronomical events, and she was a member of the team that first detected gravitational waves from the collision of black holes, thus supporting the final prediction of Einstein's general theory of relativity. Professor Mavalvala advises, quote, "If there is one thing every student should do while at Wellesley, it's to get a taste for research and open-ended inquiry." Please join me in giving the warmest of welcomes to Professor French and Professor Mavalvala.
One of the themes of the Albright Institute is that there are voices and truths surrounding us in the world, if only we have the capacity to listen and understand. And this is something that's long been known in science. If we had microwave eyes for detectors, we could go outside or even in this room, look up at the sky or look down at the floor and see the microwave radiation left over from the cosmic Big Bang 13.5 billion years ago. Alas, we didn't evolve with microwave eyes, but we did evolve with a brain to make microwave telescopes and open us to that sensory world. If only our feet and sense of touch were sufficiently sensitive, we could hear the constant rumble of earthquakes under our feet, revealing right now that we have a liquid core inside the Earth, an area that we can never tunnel into ourselves. And today, it's going to be wonderful for Nergis to open our senses to yet another aspect of the universe, the sounds of gravity itself echoing through the fabric of space-time at the speed of light, telling us about distant events long ago and far away. I think I'm delighted to be in the presence of so many future astrophysicists because I'm sure that after you've heard Nergis's presentation and had a chance to ask her some questions, you'll sign up for Astrophysics 311 2 years from now. Come back for it. Thanks so much. It's really a pleasure to share the stage, share the audience with you so that I can learn again from Nergis. Nergis, welcome back to Wellesley.
So thank you, Dick Turkis, for having me here, and Nasreen for the introduction, and to all of you, because you have to put up with this. I looked at some of your bios, and I noticed there were no physicists or astrophysicists here. So I hope oh, fantastic, good. Well, you are going to have your work cut out for you, because at the end of this, everyone should want to do astro. Take Dick's class. That was the hardest two I ever took at Wellesley. I was actually not really planning to be an astronomy major till I took those, and I said, oh, this is really hard. And so I became a physics and astronomy major. But today what I want to talk to you about is a major scientific discovery, and something that kind of took the world by storm. And I literally mean the world, because I, as a physicist, had never expected that anybody but physicists and astronomers would care about this. And it took the world by storm. And in February 2016, we made an announcement that scientists, and I was among the team that did that, had discovered gravitational waves from the collision of two black holes. Now, the first thing that one might, so what I want to do here now for the next few minutes is to unpack that announcement. What does it mean? Why should you care? You know, I'll tell you why I care along the way as well. So our story has to begin. So Dick told us about how we've observed the universe, right? Look, if you look back at the ancients, people sat out in the dark night sky, and we used our eyes to look out at stars. And we were fascinated by that. Entire myths and stories of Genesis have formed around those observations. But it was only in the last couple of hundred years that we've gotten to the place of taking those observations and creating a true scientific description of the universe. And one that's really, really important. And along the way, I'll tell you some of the reasons why. But just the very most basic question of where do we come from? Well, you can answer that in a very simple way. Say, well, we're made up of atoms, of elements. Where do those elements come from? It turns out for most elements in the universe, we don't really know where they come from. We think they have something to do with collisions of stars, and so there's one reason you might study that. So, but our story has to begin, go past starlight. So really, you know, starlight is all well and good. We look at things. We started by looking with our naked eye. We invented telescopes that can look at wavelengths that our own eyes can't see. But there's a piece of information that's missing. There's another messenger in the universe that carries information about it that we haven't been able to harness. And that's not light, it's gravity. And the person who first told us about this messenger was Einstein. So all of you have at some point or the other, whether willingly or unwillingly, had to study Newton's laws, right? And Newton said, gravity is a force. Take two massive objects, put them at some distance apart, and they will feel a force of attraction towards each other. Newton really struggled with this idea of, the math worked. He was able to predict why planets go around stars. He was able to speak of why apples fall to the ground. He was puzzled by this one question of how does the planet know about the moon, or how does the moon know about the planet? What, you know, it's called action at a distance. How do they influence each other without actually meeting, touching, chatting? And this dilemma was not answered till several hundred years later by the next great hero of gravity, and that was Einstein. And Einstein said something very important. Einstein said, gravity is not a force, gravity is geometry. Now, as you say, what does that mean? Well, that really what that means is that all of space-time, empty space, pure vacuum, actually has characteristics, shape and form and movement in it. And so Einstein's picture of space-time is that you can think of it as a membrane or a rubber sheet or a trampoline. And every time you put a massive object somewhere in space, it curves that space, just like if you put a bowling ball on the center of a trampoline. And that was these pictures you've seen of curved space-times. And so you take you cover space-time with a grid, maybe like this carpet. You put a massive object there, and that will curve. Now, if this object were not a star like our own sun, but something much, much more compact, like a black hole, which is a star that has the mass of our sun, but can have actually a very small radius of only kilometers, And so if you have an object like that, instead of this gentle curvature, space-time warps into a funnel. You've also seen funnel diagrams. Now, that's all stuff that we've either studied or seen or been fascinated by, but there's a piece of this that Einstein added that even he really didn't like. And that was, he asked the question of what happens if you take the bowling ball on the trampoline and you oscillate it up and down. You move it, accelerate it. And then he found in his theory, in his equations, that the surface of the trampoline, or the space-time itself, forms ripples. Very much like if you drop a rock on the surface of a pond and ripples spread out from where the rock fell, that's what space-time does when massive objects move. And he called those gravitational waves. They're waves that propagate over the space-time. So here's that same grid. And in this particular case, this is two stars, and these happen to be neutron stars, which are cousins of black holes. I have to introduce neutron stars and black holes because they're kind of important in the story, not just in the discovery. So black holes, I already told you, is a star like our own sun, but you let it collapse under its own gravity to a volume such that it's even light cannot escape. Okay, so that's how much gravity it has. And a neutron star is kind of its cousin. It's usually lighter than a black hole, but also a very compact star, something that has the mass of our sun, but has a radius of 10 kilometers. So let me just put that into context. Does anybody know what the radius of our sun is?
6,000.
Yes, so 700,000 kilometers. Okay, so take something that's that massive and put it into something that's the size of the town of Wellesley. Okay, it's pretty intense gravity. When you do that and these objects orbit around each other, space-time ripples, and those ripples spread out, and they spread across the universe, and Einstein also told us they go at the speed of light. Now, it turns out Einstein, even though he formulated this and this came squarely out of his equations, he did not like gravitational waves very much at all. And in fact, you know, so he formulated them in a period between 1915 and 1918. He got the first formulation in his famous 1916 paper wrong. He corrected it in 1918. But he simply, and then very shortly after Einstein's work was done, Schwarzschild, who was another scientist, actually quickly understood that if gravity behaves this way, then black holes should be possible. You should be able to take stars that fall in due to their own gravity and become so compact that light can't escape. And Schwarzschild proposed these stars in 1918. Einstein did not like these so-called dark stars at all. No light escapes, they're dark. And you know, to be fair, and he actually vacillated several times in his career about the existence of gravitational waves. Do they exist? And why did he do that? I'll tell you, there's two reasons. One is that they are extremely faint, and we're going to get to just how faint they are. They are so, so faint that when he made the numbers in those original 1915 to 18 papers, he just kind of, he dismissed them as having no practical purpose. His paper actually says that. So, and then he actually went about thinking whether they could even exist or not. He actually submitted a paper in which he, with another scientist, Rosen, in which he retracted the existence of gravitation. The title of the paper was, "Do Gravitational Waves Exist? Question mark. No, period." Okay? And then he actually retracted the retraction. And so you can see he really kind of struggled with the idea. And he was justified because they were small. And because in his time, people had not yet discovered black holes and neutron stars. They were proposed to be out there, but no one had ever seen one. No one knew if they actually exist. Are they reality? And that came after he died. So that his ambivalence was understandable. Now, there's something really, really remarkable about his theory, even though he so kind of struggled with it, which is that it made extremely precise predictions of what should happen to space-time if two black holes meet each other and start orbiting each other and collide. So he made these very, very firm predictions. And here is a movie of what that would look like. So what you're going to see is two black holes over here. This region here is going to be space-time itself and how it distorts due to these black holes that are spinning about each other and colliding. Now, we all know that the Earth orbits the Sun. It's not colliding with the Sun. Why are these things not just orbiting? Why are they colliding? Well, that was another really important piece of the gravitational waves that they radiate carry away energy. Now, where does that energy come from? It comes from the orbit. So the orbits have to get smaller and smaller, and eventually they collide. So that's what you'll see. And his theory actually shows the waveform. So on the bottom here, you'll see this looks just like a nice, pretty sine wave. But it's really an exact prediction of what those black holes will do if you could ask, how do they distort space-time? So I'll play the movie, and you'll see that as they start off being pretty benign, they just kind of go around each other. There's a little bit of space-time distortion. And then we'll zoom in close to the black holes, and you can see the funnels of space-time under each black hole. And then as these black holes get closer and closer, they'll spin faster and faster towards each other, and space-time will get extremely distorted, very, very warped by the, you know, by his geometrical picture of space-time. And eventually what you'll see is that the black holes will get so close that they'll collide. So you can see space-time is starting to get very distorted, things are moving faster, the waveform is getting built, and now look at these distortions in the shape of space-time itself. And there'll come a moment when the horizons, which is the shroud around each black hole, touch right there. We freeze the movie, and you can see the spectacular distortion of space-time. If you were anywhere near this region, you would be ripped apart in the most horrific way. So you do not wish to contemplate that. Now, what happens is the two black holes, they collide, and they merge and become one single black hole. And then these gravitational waves that were generated radiate out into the universe. Now, I'll just say a word about the closing of this movie. This movie is actually made by exact solutions to Einstein's equations, which actually, so Einstein wrote his equations in 1915, 1916, and these solutions, even for a simple system like two black holes orbiting each other, did not come till about 2005. And why? Because the equations are extremely hard to handle. They're nonlinear, they're really difficult. And these only became possible with the use of supercomputing. So that's the first thing that's important. So there's going to be few threads in my story of why this discovery came now. What happened in those 100 years? Why did it take so long? So that's the first thing. We didn't know really how to solve the equations to even predict what the waveforms should look like. Now, in the 1960s and 70s, so another really important thing happened, which was in 1967, the first neutron stars were discovered. Now, this was a revolutionary for the gravitational waves, because if you take two ordinary stars and you put them in orbit around each other, which they do, they don't really radiate strong enough gravitational waves. You'd never see it. That was the calculation Einstein did that was laughably small. Right? So now we have neutron stars, we can start doing something useful. And in fact, Kip Thorne, who was a professor at Caltech at the time, was among the pioneers to start making calculations of how strong would the signal be. And so here what I have is a very simple plot, time on this axis, just like you saw with the movie. As the black holes get closer to each other, the space-time is oscillating around them. And then he was able to put a scale on how big the signal would be. And the amplitude of the signal is this terribly, terribly small number that's 10 to the minus 21. Now, you know, many of you who've taken science classes, and the minute you put down a number and you don't put units, we dock you points, right? And here I am standing in front of you with a number that has no units. It turns out it is dimensionless. And as a result, it's not that scary, right? If it's a dimensionless number, it could be, you know, two very large quantities that are dividing out or something. It turns out I will put dimensions on it, and then you'll see why this is part of why it took so long to detect these things. So it's the amplitudes are this dimensionless unit. Now, what does this amplitude mean? So to do that, you have to ask the question, what does a gravitational wave do when it arrives here on the Earth? What it does is, as the gravitational wave propagates through space, it actually shrinks and stretches the space-time. And so if I'm a space-time object, you're a space-time object, any of this grid here on the carpet is a space-time object, as the gravitational wave comes through, it actually stretches and shrinks us at each, at the frequency of these oscillations. So if a gravitational wave were coming through me and it was oscillating at, say, once per second, I would be stretching and shrinking like this, literally, right? And so it stretches me in one direction and shrinks me in the other, and the next half cycle the other way. And it's that amount of stretching and shrinking that gives a scale to it. I'm an object of about a meter, and the stretching and shrinking, the scale is a change in length per length. What does that mean? If I'm an object of about a meter and this gravitational wave came through me, it has an amplitude of 10 to the minus 21, it would change my height by 10 to the minus 21 meters. There's the units. 10 to the minus 21 meters is actually a million times smaller than a proton. Okay, so now you get a sense. So this is now, think about the scale. The proton itself is 10,000 times smaller than the atom. So we're just talking about a scale that really Einstein was justified to laugh at and say, this is crazy, this will never happen. Now, it turns out that at the same time these neutron stars had been discovered, Thorne was starting to make these predictions, another crazy guy was on the scene, and that was Professor Ray Weiss at MIT. And he asked this very profound question of what is measurable about gravitational waves. And he quickly understood that if space-time is shrinking and stretching like this, and if you could use a laser interferometer, and I'll tell you in a moment how it works, you could actually make this measurement. You could actually, by measuring how much light leaves this instrument that's being stretched and shrunk by the passing gravitational wave, you could actually make a measurement of this very small effect of stretching and shrinking, and he put a number on it. He was kind of bold. He understood also very quickly that you had to make it long. And here is the scale. So if you have the amplitude of the gravitational wave is h, the amount of change in length that you would need is proportional to the length. And so he immediately understood that me, a 1 meter size object, is kind of useless. It has to be much longer. You know, initially started off as being 100 kilometers long. That was impractical and expensive. And eventually they settled on 4,000 meters or 4 kilometers or 2.5 miles. So it's a very long interferometer where these laser beams travel. And that allows us to make a measurement, a change in distance of 10 to the minus 18 meters, which is only 1,000 times smaller than a proton. And he said, OK, that's doable. We'll do it. OK, and that's so. And so there, a bold experiment was born. And the bold experiment was Weiss, who said, let's use laser interferometers. He understood you had to make them very long for this reason of the change in length being proportional to the length of the instrument. There was Thorne, who said we have to understand the astrophysics, and he understood how small the amplitudes of the waves were. There was another man named Drever who added some technical details to the instrument. And these are the three names you will see whenever you hear about the LIGO discovery and all the prizes and all the speculation about Nobels, et cetera. These are the three guys you see. And there's a fourth person who came quite a bit later. So this all happened in the 70s. And then in the early 1990s, Barry Barish took over, and he took over as a project manager. And this is really important in doing big science. He understood that this bunch of scientists are really clever, brilliant, but they don't know how to go from doing science in their labs to building a billion-dollar instrument. And so he kind of was the person who kind of led the community from tabletop science to national scale, international scale instruments. Now, one of the things that I'm very aware of when I put up a slide like this is that people in this room, especially a room full of women, would think that all of this science is done only by the men. And so I want to put up another slide here, which is this was a slide from the announcement in February 2016, and the experiment had been executed over 40 years. I will come back to that. Weiss's initial proposal was in 1972. Okay? And so you can see this, the women in the group, and this is only a small fraction because people were not all gathered in the same room. The spokesperson who announced the result to the world, Gabriela Gonzalez, leader of the data analysis groups are the two women here. Leader of the astrophysics group is a woman here. One of the lead scientists in the instrumentation group is here. So women are there. They're just not in that first tier that came in the 60s and 70s. And we can have long discussions about why, but we won't. Okay, now here's the instruments themselves. So in the United States, Weiss's proposal became two detectors called LIGO, the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory. One of them is in the desert in Washington, and the other one is in the swamps of Louisiana. Okay? And the idea is to keep them spatially well separated, because one of the hardest things is, now remember, I've told you that we're going to make a measurement where we're going to see mirrors that are placed 4 kilometers apart move by 1,000th the size of a proton, right? This is what we're trying to do, right? And so to do that, you have to protect these mirrors that are part of these interferometers from all other external forces. You do that as well as you can, but then you have two of them so that if you do have some forces that are terrestrial, that are generated on the Earth, they will show up in both detectors in a well-known way and differently than an astrophysical source would show up. And that's why you have two, and you'll see later in the spirit of the Institute's, in the winter session theme here of globalization, you'll see that it turns out this is only two of a global network of detectors. So what do you have to do? You have to do two things to make these things work. The first thing you have to do is you have to take the mirrors of the interferometer. And let me just say how the interferometer works. I kind of didn't go into that. It's basically you start with a laser beam in one corner. You split it into two parts. It travels for 4 kilometers in an L shape along the two arms of the L. It reflects from mirrors at each end of the L. And it comes back. And then if the wave interferes constructively, which means if the peaks line up with the peaks, then you get all the light out. If the peaks line up with the troughs, none of the light comes out. And whether the peaks and troughs line up or not depends on the length of the instrument. So that's how the measurement is made. And so to do that, you have to make mirrors that are so still that only the gravitational wave moves them. So for that, you have tremendous amounts of things like vibration isolation and thermal mitigation. So that's what costs the $1 billion in the end. The idea is so simple, right? An interferometer of that size, of a meter, we could make in one afternoon in the Science Center. But when you get to the scale of what you're trying to do, it gets harder. Now, the other thing you have to do is, if once you've made the mirrors so still, it's kind of useless if you don't have a means of measuring such tiny motion. And to do that, you need a very, so that's another part of the vibration isolation of the mirrors. The LIGO mirrors are kind of big. They're sort of 35 centimeters in diameter. And once you do that, you also need a good meter stick to measure small motions. And it turns out our meter stick is a laser, but a rather sophisticated one, not like this laser, for example. This laser pointer, green, puts out about 5 milliwatts of light. This laser puts out 200 watts of light. So, you know, it's the kind of thing where you know, even if you graze the beam, you know, you will lose your tissue. So it's burn worthy. That's what the instrument looks like. And the whole thing in the United States was funded by the National Science Foundation. And I really want you to remember this, because this is going to come back to our story of how something like this gets done at all. So in September 2015, we saw two black holes collide. This is what they looked like. So they collided, and as you saw from the previous simulation, the gravitational waves traveled out into the universe. And then, remarkably, 1 billion years later, they arrived at our beautiful Earth. And even more remarkably, we had instruments on the air that were capable of detecting them. So here come the gravitational waves, first hitting the instrument in Louisiana, and then 7 milliseconds later arriving at the instrument in Washington. And from that time difference, we could tell where the wave comes from. And yeah, so the effect is highly exaggerated. It didn't do that. It moved by, I will show you, it moved the mirrors, as promised, 10 to the minus 18 meters. So here was the signals that were recorded at the two observatories, time on this axis, and that amplitude of gravitational wave on the vertical axis, which corresponds to a motion of the mirrors of a few times 10 to the minus 18 meters. So these instruments were up, they were running, they recorded the signal, and remarkably, from Einstein's equations, you can exactly back out what those black holes were doing. And what we found was that the black holes had roughly 30 times the mass of our sun, which was a surprise. People don't really know how to assemble black holes of that size. They were going at half the speed of light just before they collided. Just wrap your head around this. Something that's 30 times the mass of our sun whipping around at half the speed of light. You really don't want to be there. And happily for us, we weren't. It's 1.3 billion light years away. So it's a quite distant system. And in that moment, in this last moment, when the two black holes collide, when the signal amplitude is the largest, energy that was three times the mass of our sun was released in that sort of fraction of a second, in those 100 milliseconds, which is believed to be the single most energetic event in the universe. Just in that short a time, that much energy being released. Okay, now why all the excitement? What does it mean to you? Well, it's the first direct detection of gravitational waves. Now, why should you care? So Einstein, obscure, you know, general relativity, should we care? Well, we care about general relativity for one reason that you all probably know, which is GPS. Without general relativistic connection, if we only knew Newton's laws of gravity, our GPS would put us in the wrong place in within seconds by, you know, hundreds of meters, and very soon by kilometers, and it would not work. So we like general relativity because it's useful to us, and we carry it in our cell phones all the time. Why is this so interesting? This is interesting because, remember, black holes give off no light. If we had pointed the best telescopes we have at those two black holes colliding, we probably would have seen nothing. So now we have a tool by which we can actually look at dark objects in the universe. And so one of the ways in which scientists and poets have liked to think about this is that until now we used light. It was like going to the movies but seeing silent movies. And then suddenly we've turned on sound, because we can encode those signals into sound. And I won't play the sound clip, but I'll just tell you what it would sound like. If those black holes were encoded into a band that our human ears could hear, you would hear a chirp. It would go like this. And that last bit is when they collide. And so so we've turned on this new way of observing the universe. It's also the first direct observation of watching in real time two black holes collide. Okay, so that was a very elegant part of the discovery. It's also the first test of Einstein's theory in something called the strong field limit. Now, I'll tell you something just fun about it. Now, you shouldn't care about what the strong field limit is. It simply means it's where gravity is strong. Why you should care is that Newton's theory of gravity worked really, really well in the 1700s, except for one well-known failure. It could not predict the orbit of Mercury. It predicted the orbits of all the other planets really well, but not Mercury. What's special about Mercury? Anyone know? It's closest to the sun. Gravity there is strongest. And in that strength of gravity, Newton's theory failed, and Einstein's theory was successful. So there's no reason for us to think Einstein's theory should be successful around black holes. But so far, so good, it has been. Okay? And then finally, for me, my personal side of it is I've worked for the last 25 years on building the instruments. So I was really nice to see the machine works too. And it works at that attometer precision, at the precision that was needed to do that. And so really the big story here is that we've turned on this new way of looking at the universe, and every time scientists have turned new instruments to the sky, we have actually found things we didn't predict. So I'm not going to stand here and tell you what they are because I'm not imaginative enough. But you know, nature, amazingly, always trumps our own imagination. So I'll just say good things will come next. This, I told you it caught the world by storm, I'll just tell you. So here's a fun thing. This was a sign on a New York subway. Okay, and it says, scientists found gravitational waves in outer space. And this was in March 2016, shortly after the announcement. And this is what I mean. I really thought the scientific community would be excited, but I never thought, you know, subway riders in New York City would care. Now, I noticed that some of you here are economists. My sister is in the audience, and she's an actuary, so I thought I'd put this one up, too. I like it a fair bit. So it says, your pension fund fell so dramatically that scientists were able to detect its gravitational waves. Okay? I could put up, you know, dozens of cartoons that came out after this discovery that people were trying to connect to the discovery in their sphere. So it kind of made people excited. Now I want to turn a little bit to what it means really. Galileo, we believe, is the first person who turned a telescope to the sky, and that was in 1609. It was kind of a, by modern standards, a completely, you know, mediocre instrument. It was a little 1.5-inch diameter mirror, and he saw that Venus had phases. He saw some rings on Saturn. All things that, by today's standards, are completely, you know, pedestrian. But there was a really important historical moment there, and the paradigm shift that no longer do we use our naked eye to look at the universe, but we can use instruments. And from there on, we have invented amazing instruments. And if people haven't taken an intro astronomy course, take one here, because we have some beautiful telescopes right here on campus. In the meantime, you know, so in the 400 years since Galileo, we've not only invented bigger and bigger telescopes which work with our, you know, in the frequencies of our own eyes, but we've also invented telescopes in space that can look at infrared radiation, they can look at gamma rays, all different colors of light. And now finally we're at the place where we have turned on the sounds, and we're hoping to map out the universe in the same way. So that's where this is going to go. There's a global network of gravitational detectors. There's the two in the US, but there's also a 3-kilometer detector in Europe called Virgo, a 3-kilometer detector being built in Japan called Kagra, a planned 4-kilometer detector in India, and then there's actually a small 600-meter detector in Germany that, because it's too short, isn't likely to be as competitive as these others. There's even a plan for a detector in space where the length of the detector is 5 million kilometers. So, and that makes the measurement much easier, because now you have to measure changes in spacing of, you take two spacecraft, you put them 5 million kilometers apart, and you ask if they're moving by 10 to the minus 12 meters. Sounds easy, right? So, easy compared to the terrestrial measurements, but it's still a very hard experiment. So I want to just spend a couple of minutes now on looking at how science got done. So typically when you do big science like this, you go, there's a process, and the most important piece of this process is the second one here, which is consensus. Okay, so you go from conception to consensus to construction, and then eventually to operations and discovery, if you're lucky. So in the case of LIGO, 1968, Weiss conceived this idea whilst he was teaching a course on general relativity. So that's the other thing you should know, is that you know, you never know when a problem set you're doing is going to turn into a major discovery some decades later. Okay, and so he assigned this problem on a problem set. In 1972, he presented the first detailed calculations for kilometer-long detectors, and he didn't even publish it. It was in some quarterly report. okay, and still not published, by the way. The most important paper of the field is in a quarterly report. Okay, then he went to the NSF, the National Science Foundation, and said, fund this. And then came the process of consensus building. How do you do that? How do you go from this crazy idea, this mad scientist wants to measure, you know, 10 to the minus 18 meters. So there were all kinds of studies that were funded by the National Science Foundation through the National Research Council. These are all acronyms you don't need to remember. The thing I want you to carry away is consensus. And where does consensus come from? It comes from two places. It comes from the scientific community, and it comes from the people who write the checks, Congress. Okay? So in 1984, LIGO was founded as a Caltech-MIT project after these industry studies and the National Research Council approval. In 1986, physicists got together and did a decadal survey. That means surveying what physics is doing for the next 10 years. And a special panel that was put together that endorsed LIGO as a good idea to do. And everybody always said, every document you read will say, this is a crazy idea. This is, has great risk. It may never work, but if it does, it's totally worth doing. That's the summary of most of those reports. The National Science Board in 1990 approves LIGO as a construction proposal. 1992, the sites are chosen in Washington and Louisiana. 1994, construction begins. Remember the date 1994, I'm going to come back to that. In 2002, the first instruments are built. We see nothing. In 2010, we give up on those instruments and build a next generation of instruments for another $200 million. And then in 2015, we start observing with those new improved instruments, and within the first hours of operation with the new instrument, we detect the first signal, okay? And so you can see, I mean, I joined this in 1990, but you can see the field has been going for a long time. So let me just say a little bit more about how science happens. So the National Science Foundation found itself in a very strange place. It had never done anything that was as big or as costly as LIGO, even at the early phases of LIGO when it was only $300 million. And eventually, over its lifetime, it's been $1.1 billion. Now, as a result, a new instrument had to be invented, which was called the Major Research Equipment and Facilities Construction. It's actually just known as MREFC, which still exists at the National Science Foundation. It was an instrument for going directly to Congress and saying, we would like, you know, the scientific consensus says this is an important instrument to build. Will you fund it separate to our own budget? And that's an instrument that has been used for many, many science projects since then, okay? Now, I want to wrap up with tying this story of LIGO into my own story a little bit. And so I'll name my story Starlight to Brilliant Darkness, because I started my thoughts about astronomy and physics came for most of us by looking at the sky, and that was starlight. And then I quickly sort of saw the error of my ways, and I went after darkness. Okay, so how did that work? So my whole story can be titled, you know, mentors and partners, partnerships and mentoring is really how it happened. So it began with when I was in high school, and I used to work on bicycles and bicycle repairs, and that's how I learned about sort of tools. And then I also had a chemistry teacher who would allow me to sort of concoct the most amazing concoctions in chemistry lab. And that sort of grew my passion for just doing things with my hands. My chemistry teacher, it turns out, was actually part of a rebel movement in Sri Lanka, and as a result knew how to make Molotov cocktails and all kinds of things that were, you know, that. But I want to just say, that's what sparks your interest. If you just go every old day and say, okay, I'm going to mix hydrogen chloride, boring. You have to do something a little bit more exciting. So that's how it began. Then came the first forays into research for me, and that was right here at Wellesley College. And I actually see who snuck in the back of the room, Robbie Berg. So that was my first taste of research. Robbie took me into his lab, and one of the very first things we had to do was to rebuild a homemade laser. And he told me he didn't want to rebuild it. He said, clean a mirror. I never worked with a laser mirror. I took the whole thing apart and I cleaned the mirror, and I had no idea how to put it back. And we spent most of the rest of that summer just reconstructing the laser. I hope you don't mind my exposing my foolishness. So that's how it began. But you know, the lesson there was that it taught me that apparatus is not something you can buy. It's not something that you can just simply turn on. It's something that you actually nurture and tease results out of. And that's really the lesson for LIGO, because nothing in LIGO can you buy. And you're doing, you know, experiments at that precision, you have to invent everything. So that's how that happened. Then I went to graduate school at MIT, and that was early on, that was a period of great fumbling and stumbling and lots of grumbling, and I didn't really know what I wanted to do. I was a little bit lost. And then I came upon a very chance encounter, and that was with Ray Weiss, whose name you've seen many times. Ray Weiss was a professor at MIT. I was looking for a group to join. I went to see him to see if he had any room for me, and he asked me the most peculiar question. He said, "What do you know?" I was like, "I know lots of things. I've just finished graduate quantum mechanics and stat mech." And he stopped me dead in my tracks. And he said, "I don't care about any of that textbook stuff. What do you know how to do?" So I told him I knew how to use a machine shop. I knew how to build electronics, all the things I learned in Robbie's lab. And he also stopped me again dead in my tracks. "Oh, you're OK. You can come work for me." And that's how I started in LIGO. I had no idea what LIGO was. I was just looking for something interesting to do. And in fact, after I started, when he then told me what LIGO was and this 10 to the minus 18 measurement, I thought it was completely nuts. But then I also got addicted to it. It's one of these things, right, where the goal is always just so close. And he told me this was in 1991. He told me, "In the next 5 years, we're going to build LIGO and detect gravitational waves." And I bought it. And I still tell my students that. I worked, during my work at LIGO, had lots of fun things. So here's a fun picture of myself working at the LIGO Washington Observatory, and we're not working. As you can see, we're standing on the roof watching a tremendous desert fire that was threatening the observatory, you know. So there are some exciting times as well. It turned out that those 4 kilometer long arms of LIGO and the concrete barrier turned out to be a fire break for a fire that actually had extended 25,000 acres. So it was pretty amazing. Okay, then I went to MIT to join the faculty, and that I call that the period of the headless chicken, because I felt like a chicken with its head cut off. I had no idea what I was doing. I was doing too many things. In those years, I was building my own research group. And one of the things that I learned, and this is really important for all of you who are thinking about what to do next and how you'll do it, my students led the way. You know, I had some ideas, how would we do it? My students and I built a new research group, and through that came some really unplanned paths. We made discoveries of things we had never planned to, that came from building an experiment to do one thing, and then suddenly we saw something else, and I got some nice results out of that. And that led to some recognition, which I always also say, you know, I get some of this recognition. You heard about the MacArthur. Really, my students, and I could not have done it without my students and colleagues. So this is what I mean by the partners. So there are the mentors, and then there's the partners. Of course, in 2015, we made the discovery of a lifetime. I have to say, as a scientist, nothing could ever compare to that moment when you see something you've been doing for 25 years and your mentors have been doing for 45 years. And so that came about. And then in the meantime, I've also managed to have a family. I have an 8-year-old son and an 8-week-old son. So that's my story. Thank you for listening. So.